Hey, how you doing, guys? It's me again. It's as simple as that. Today I'm gonna be explaining a little bit more on the detail on how to test on this motor and how far I am with the controller. Obviously not too far with this controller because that one is burnt. And the only reason I burned it is to find the proper way to see what's coming out of the controller. I find out if you hook up the controller when the legs are all running, when the stator is spinning and all that stuff, you're getting a variable volting, a volt in your voltmeter, and that means you're not getting a true reading. And for the longest time, I was saying Heinheind produce radio volts, not regular volt from the outlets. And the only way you can do that to picking up the proper voltage coming up from the leg of this controller is to be able to spin the motor on two legs, which it will start. It won't burn anything, but it will start. And then from there, the third leg was empty, you hook up your voltmeter, click it on, and since it's radio wave, you need an antenna. You became the antenna. And you will see your volt coming up, and it will stabilize and your voltmeter, and you will be able to have a true reading at how much volt it's putting out. The Heinheind controller says it's putting 126 to 130 volts. It's not true. It's 120 volt divided by 3, which is 40 volt per legs. It's not an amount of volt on the top of each other. It's per legs. So when you're running two legs, you're getting 80 volts split in two, 40 volts per legs. Then you put a third leg on, you get another 40 volt. That's 120 volts divided by 3. The speed. When I said the voltage, the speed, that's what I burned the Heinheind controller. I decided since those guys only put 40 volt each, what about if I connect this one here on the top of the middle one? Well, guess what happened at that point in time? The motor speed up twice as fast. It increases. So multiplying the voltage per stator rack is the way the motor get the speed. So getting 1500 RPM at 40 volt output DC on radio wave, it was pretty amazing. And we cannot work with Heinheind, obviously, because they don't want to work with us. We've been talking to Ottawa, up to I think the vice president of the company, and all we did is spin our wheels for 4.5 months and waste our time. They asked us money to produce a controller to work so they can keep the right of the controller and sell it to us again. So that means we have to pay for the development for something they're going to be making money. As far as I'm concerned, Heinheind can go and fuck itself, literally. I don't have any reason to work with this controller. It's garbage, it's going to go in the garbage. I'm going to remove the switch little button and keep the casing for something else, but the gut of the Heinheind goes in the garbage. So anyway, that's the Heinheind. Now, a lot of people have a problem. They always come to me and tell me what those motor run on, because they're too goddamn stupid to read on a drum stamped by the company exactly what the voltage. And the volt, it says DC, 310 volt DC at 0.94 of a horse, HP. Now, I don't want to hear any more people telling me the motor doesn't run on high voltage. This one, it's from a Samsung, runs on 310 volt DC. So please, get your facts straight. When you don't want to, if you want to say something, make sure you went out there and you spend the time and the money to buy the object and read what is on it before you start arguing with me. Because this is the fact, it's stamped by the factory right on the drum, all right? And another thing we find out, the steel drum, each magnet has actually 4 magnets into it. And the blue or the plastic one, this become white, yellow, and green, and blue. They have the same bar of magnet, but there's only 3 magnets per blocks. So that makes a big difference on how many pull you have on your stator. The one here from the Samsung is a 12-pole motor. This one, it's a 3-pole motor. That's the difference. 12-pole, 3-pole makes a big difference on the controller also. Since I've been wasting my time for 4.5 months with people say they can do this, they can do that with electrical controller, try this, try that. Instead sending me stuff to tell me to try this and try that, you purchase a motor, you put it on the shaft, and you go and purchase all the stuff you guys sending me, and you make that motor turn, and then send me a video, say, hey Gerard, we find a controller work for your motor, that's the motor, and you send me a video of that motor spinning 5,000 RPM. That's all I want to know. I don't want to know, you know, oh, go to Kane Tower and buy this, or go to Simpsons here and buy that, that's going to work. No, no, I want to see your ass on the front of a camera with a motor like this, with spin at 5,000 RPM, with the controller you find who says work. Beside that, I don't want to hear nothing, because it's just blowing smoke up my ass, and I don't like it.
So those stators, they are wired differently, correct?
The stairs are wired differently. You can look at the stairs. Soon you look at the stair, you can see the configuration of the wiring is totally different. Some they jump every six legs. Some they jump. That's when they jump every three. You get three legs, three phase. You got three legs, and it goes around like this. Every three legs, that's in the same stator. The same wire goes on and on and on to go to the full 360 degrees. Now it's very simple. 360 degrees, that one is perfectly calculated on 360 degrees. 36 stators, right? That's 360 degrees. Divided by 3 phase. 36 leg divided by 3, what's that going to give you? 12. That's called 12 pole. You can ask any motor winding company, and they will tell you the same thing. It's a 12 pole motor in 3 phase. So, Now we pretty much, you know, on the controllers and where we at and stuff like this. The generator, you probably see a little bit of it. I don't like to put too much on it, but anyway, it's got very strong magnet. The other part of the generator, which is just, that's just a casing. The other part of the generator is only this big and is about 6 inch long. And when I'm finished with it, it will be putting up 16,000 volts, radio wave. Radio volt. We don't need plug volt to make power. We need radio volt, which is totally different. And at that point in time, I'm just waiting for the parts. The controller, I'm going mechanical because I can run the three phase really easily with a mechanical controller. I'm just using an old distributor, the internal part of an old distributor from a GM. I'm modifying a little bit, and it will be just straight mechanical, and I'll be able to achieve, if the GM can achieve 14,000 RPM under V8 motor, I will be able to achieve the same thing on that one, because it's no difference between a piston drive motor timing or those motor timing when you understand what is going on. So that's what I'm doing with the controllers, you know. I'm staying away from the electronic controller because so far I waste my time. People's asking you for a massive amount of money to work, to do something, and you want to keep the right, or if you come up with a controller, do you want to be able to, I own the controller now, it's my design and stuff like that, but we have to pay them to do this work. It doesn't work that way in the real world. If your store doesn't have anything on a shelf, I turn around and go someplace else, if you don't have anything to sell me. So, now, this is, you know, you will be also find, you will see another video I'm putting out there. It's going to be to explain how the old analog meter, if you want to take a loose shot on that one, how those one works, how they calculate your, how they function inside and calculate your wattage, your usage. And I will be doing a test on that. I'm going to plug into my system and then find out exactly if I'm getting anything out of the neutral wire. And if the neutral wire makes this little wheel spin, that's mean we have, you know, Houston will have a problem. That's mean my watts is going out of the door. So that's another test going to be in the next couple of 2 or 3 days. I'm going to be able to do that. I just want to pick up some parts today so I can finish that. as you see, I work in multiple ways. You know, when I study something, I take everything apart. Everything is apart. It's not one thing. It's not a part. I have to know what makes them ticks and makes them work. Everything is a part, right? So when I go in to figure out something, I don't waste anything. I just take everything apart and then start reverse engineering on everything, and then I know exactly what is going on in those boxes. And then I will be able to explain more how you're getting screw on your hydro bill. You know, it's very simple. Those things only works on the highest demand on line one and line two. You cannot make the little wheel spin faster unless the higher leg get passed by the secondary legs on a higher draws. That's the only thing that little wheel will draw faster. It only have one speed and per legs. But the new meter, what it does is they charge you for a two-phase service when you have a contract for a single-phase service. So that's how your meter gets really, really, really high, and your bill's getting really high. People don't understand what, but there it is. You're getting charged for two wires instead of one. So
what about schematics and diagrams? People ask for those all the time.
Well, I will never have a schematic and diagram out. People is going to have to figure it out with the video I'm doing and duplicate with video. I don't know. In the old day, a picture meant a million words. Today, a picture means nothing because people have the, what do you call that? They have, they cannot focus on anything, you know. They have less focusing than a net fly. So, look at it. I mean, I'm working and developing something people have been looking at for over 150 years and tried to figure it out. It changed every day. Right? It's like asking for the guy who invented the first car, do you have a part list? Right? Well, the schematic never changed from a car from Ford, put the first car to the last car on the road today from Ford. What's the part list? Sometimes the new car comes out, they don't have a part list out for the dealer because they're still doing some change. So it's just not a finished product I'm doing. Those are prototypes. Now, all you have to do is look at it and say, okay, I will show you the parts, how to build stuff, but you're going to have the effort to go out there and go get your own part. And if you do not have mechanical incline, do not try it. You will not succeed it. You have to be able mechanically to be able to do this. Okay, I mean, in the beginning I said, if you know how to change a spare tire, you should be able to do that, and that was absolutely right, but guess what? 98% of the civilization today could not change the flat tires. It's pretty sad today, you know, the way the world is turning.
So what about the generator in Australia? Are you still going to be developing that?
Yeah, I'm going to still be developing that because it's just a different style of generator, but it's pretty much the same style I'm doing. I'm just doing it a little bit longer and smaller, and I'm removing the iron out of it. The iron ain't your friend. The iron literally is a brake, heat production, and it eats 60% of the production of energy you created in a generator. If you remove all the iron out of a generator, you would have a generator would run, instead of being 100 horsepower diesel, you would need a 5 horse diesel power on it to produce the same amount of energy. So iron is not your friend. And I find out element. When I say element, learn how your element works. The electromagnetic fields of any type of metal, you have to learn if they will be able to work together. And if they work together, and what way? Negatively or positively? You have to learn your metal and what electromagnetic field each metal carries. There's many type of electromagnetic field. You know, aluminum have electromagnetic field, copper have electromagnetic field. I mean, you know, fresh dog shit in the street have an electromagnetic field. You have to be able to read that field to be able to see if they're compatible. right? I know you're going over a lot of people's head and stuff like that. So I will never be able. That's fine. It's a lot of people, they cannot put a car together. But there's a lot of people out there who know how to put a car together. So ask the guy next door to you to put it together. If you're not mechanically inclined to do something like this, ask someone who's mechanically inclined and say, oh yeah, I can put that together, right? Buy him a couple of cases of beer and he'll put it together. Supply him all the parts, he'll put it together. It's not that very hard, I mean, but you have to be mechanically inclined to it. You have to know which part of a screwdriver you're going to hold. Without knowing that, good luck.
So someone asked a question specifically and said, is there a way to receive a 7.5 hertz signal to power a DC motor for an e-bike application?
Well, that's a good question, actually. I came up with something people won't like to hear. He's talking about the earth frequency, 7.5. That's mean earth batteries and picking up and extracting energy from the earth. We've been doing that for 200 years. We've been disturbing the undercrust of the earth for 200 years. We've been cutting every single wire system of this planet and capacitor. When you're having a deposit of coal or a deposit of oil or a deposit of anything, it's called battery or capacitor. It's a large amount of material or actually can hold a massive amount of capacity. Now we're digging that out. And during that time, if you go back in history, the North Pole didn't move very much. It used to move like a fraction of an inch every year. Now, that you can't run fast enough to follow the North Pole. And people's asking why. Well, if I go into your house and I'm just one of those guys who like to steal coppers, and I start digging through your wall and stealing a little piece of copper here and there from your wire, pretty soon your whole house ain't going to work properly because nothing is going to turn on because you just cut all the line going to supply the power to whatever you need to be used. And that's, the earth is no different. We're cutting a massive amount of wiring. It's a very delicate wiring system. It's probably one of the most sophisticated. And if we keep doing that, we're going to weaken up the electromagnetic field, as is, we know is already weakening quite a bit. And countries, in developed countries, who mine or have the most mining in the world are the ones who have the most problem with electromagnetic field. Well, I wonder why. The scientists cannot figure that one out. Well, if they just, get their head out of their ass and think a little bit what we've been doing for the last 150 years, they would figure it out. But no, I will not tap into the earth to get power. Power, Tesla tried that and had a bad response with that. And, he tried to send a massive amount of voltage into the earth. 5 miles away, he blew a whole power station, every single transformer. It was like Christmas, not Christmas, but New Year's. It was like a firework inside the building, the powerhouse. So it didn't work very well. And that's why Tesla, when he burned his lab in Long Island, England, and he came into North America, New York, he never rebuilt one of those big towers. Why? If that guy was known that was the right direction, he had all the backing at that time, he would have rebuilt another big tower someplace in the States. But he went instead air communication, wireless communication. And no one's asking that why question. Why suddenly you just give up that big tower? I mean, you're giving up 60 tons of copper. Why you not duplicate that someplace else? It's because he had a reason. It didn't work properly. It was not, you're not controlled. So, that's the reason I will...
So what's your views on Dr. Kashi's
system? Oh gosh, Kashi's
system.
I try to get some information on Kashi. I mean, we have, I send him an email and ask him to send me a video, like I do, of his own personal work. Instead, they sent me into the forum to see all everybody else's work. So I did that, and I saw a couple of people. When they plug it to the wall and they hook it up, spark came up, the new thing, smoke came up, and some. But I never see anything really working because you plug to the wall. So I mean, there's a few guys, oh, look at that, I got a light bulb. Well, shit, you plug to the wall too. Like, you know, why bother doing all that when you're plugging into the wall, right? I know you're supposed to energize, right? Sure, you energize, but you see, if you're talking about something is going to be taking over your house.
Yeah, but there's, there's some plasma in there somehow.
Well, that's another thing. I mean, the plasma, you won't be able to see a light, some kind of spark, some kind of gas. You know, that's what plasma is. Plasma is like, you know, we're living in a world of pollution. It's almost impossible unless you have totally enclosed tube to have an invisible plasma. If it's open air, you will see it in the dark. You turn the light off, the thing will glow either green, purple, blue, whatever gas you're breathing that day, that color gas will show up in the plasma because that's what the plasma burns it. It turns the color. So literally, at that point in time, I don't think he's playing with plasma, but you know, he's been doing that for 40 years, so he must know what he's doing.
Yeah, but he talked about plasma being very smart. So if you were negative, positive thinking, plasma would work one way or the other?
Okay, I got some comedian in the back here. Well, I would say some energy have intelligence. I'm not too sure if it's plasma. I believe virgin electrons have intelligence. When I mean virgin, I mean man-made electrons, which is fresh, and it's not being into this world for like a nanosecond, have intelligence. I have some effect on some of the small machine I built, and now I'm 100% sure that's what we're doing. We're manufacturing electrons, just like Tesla did it. Tesla did it a little bit differently because he started with the magnet and he went away from the magnet because the magnet was not strong enough, and he was a better manipulation of iron and copper, and that's why we went to iron and copper. But As plasma have intelligence, is up to see. But to tell me if I go in my place and someone piss me off in the road, and soon I get to the house, the light turns off, well, I will be over pissed off in that time because something is going to be flying out the window, and it will be that unit was shutting off my power, you know, if that's what it is. So, but
you know someone personally though who's.
I know a guy who is followed my work very close, and he's in the States, and he worked for one of the largest R&D company in the States, and they're testing it. They're testing this whole thing up to make sure if, you know, they think if it goes into the, if it produces heater, we might have something. But they're having a problem right now for nano coating and all that stuff. You know, they're using a different mixture for nano coating, so they're going to be testing that. But like, you know, I put a feeling on people. You know, if anybody have a website or an address for me to go and look and some under his work? I mean, the guy's been up for 40 years. Okay, I mean, like, you know, he must have started that when he was in his 20s, right? So I mean, like, you know, I just want to see on video what he did in the beginning, and that would be something to see, because then we'd be able to see the beginning of his stuff and how he was doing it and how far he did in 40 years. But when I got someone respond to me, and I believe it was an engineer, and they tested his unit, and they told me, so well, you see, the cachet system doesn't really work. But one thing works really well on cashing, and I'm quoting somebody else, it's not me, right? He said, the donation button works really well on all his website. That's the only thing really works. Soon you hit that, man, they respond to you like immediately. And I have the same problem. I sent another email and said, listen, I just want to see something of his work. And so far, it's been how many weeks, 3 weeks now? No response whatsoever with Keshi. So I'm not holding my breath because I can't hold it that long. So I'm just going to keep on going what I'm doing, and I don't really pay attention to other people's work. I'm busy doing my own research. what I find out with my own hand is more likely more credentialed than anybody's going to tell me something. You know, if I get mad, I'm going to lose my power, you know, in the house. So that will answer that question.
What about deadlines?
Oh, deadlines. I love deadlines. You know what? I treat deadlines like toilet paper. When you run out of toilet paper, what do you do? You know, wait for the next deadline. Now you get up, get another roll, and throw it on the rack. It's that simple as that. When you're inventing something or designing something or doing research, anybody who put a deadline on you is only there for one purpose, for money, because he's got an investor. Like, you can't have a deadline on something you try to, like, 150 years and no one figured out Tesla yet. And people are putting deadline on try to figure that one out. Well, my deadline, I can put your deadline, and 150 more years, I'll have my deadline. So if you want to live and stay on tune for that long, then you will see my deadline, because I'll be dead.
So you're going to show us some more after we cut here?
Yeah, I'm going to show you a little bit more. That's my micro lab you guys are looking at. It's a messy, but I do not have to go anywhere and drive anywhere, and it's warm. And I can come up here and work in my jammy if I feel like it in the middle of the night. It's messy, it's a rat's nest, but I accomplished to do my research and get things happening. So, at that point in time, I think we answered all the questions, or you have more questions?
Well, I think that's pretty much it. People just want to always know about parts, but I think you told them that pretty much at the beginning.
Yeah, the part list, like, you know, too, we have a tall finish unit who's been tested for months. We're talking about months, 6 months plus. I will not have part list for less than that, because it's just a waste of time.
But you're still open to widely sharing with people.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, like, you know, if I didn't share with people, I wouldn't make a video. You know, I wouldn't show the inside of my rat's nest. I wouldn't show the new stuff I'm putting out, you know, for testing. You know, it's all about testing. You know, that's how you do research, testing. Don't listen to nobody. Do it yourself, you know, because doing research by reading someone else's garbage, all you're going to do is rephrase someone else's garbage. You won't be able to phrase your own garbage. Like, let's be unique here. Do something in your own and test it. And then be the judge what the test came up, right? Use the right equipment. If you want to duplicate a test, duplicate it. It's got to be the same thing. It might not have to look the same thing, but the compartment have to be the same thing. So, at that point in time, might as well swing. We'll go to the next bench, and I will update you on a smaller unit, which I did a little bit better, so because I'm using it for testing. All right, that's the upgrade here. I'm going to show you on a small unit, the one that used to be in my coffee table in the front, and in my where I was living in a trailer. It got a little bit better. I use a very simple timer. You can find that in hardware store from 1 hour to 10 minutes. I got a ceiling fan speed control, which doesn't make your motor hum as bad as a dimmer for light. You don't want to use dimmer for light, you'll burn your motor. The motor I use is no longer a RC or small motor. I use a magic bullet motor. And I'm just going to reach you for example. When I say magic bullet, I'm not kidding. This is that motor inside here I use. It's really quiet. Very nice. It turns 15,000 RPM, so you get lots of RPM to adjust your speed. And the $40 at Walmart. Here you go. You want part list? Walmart. $40. Here we go. I'm doing commercial for Walmart now, for God's sakes. So that's the one place to get the motor, because buying the motor itself is about $180 if you order that motor by itself. Spark gap. I just went and picked up some nylon, you know, it was a flat bar, got it cut up, they machined it up, put a hole in the middle and drilled perfectly right through. And what I do is I cut some rods that are pure Dexton electrode, so they do not burn with the high voltage. And I just cut it to the length, right, those ones are 332, 7 inch long, fairly expensive, but not cheap. But they work really well, and that's what my new spark got.
All right, it's nice looking.
and it's very insulated. I can, if you want to, we can run. If I turn that off, I'll just turn one light off so it's not so bright on the camera. And I'm just going to turn this thing on. This is how noisy the thing is. It's pretty quiet. The motor never heats off. Now, the pump I use now is not a washing machine pump anymore. It's a dishwashing pump. And it's a little bit bigger pump. You get a better magnet into it. And here again, here's the number. So everybody can get that, right? So we get that nice and good.
Beautiful.
The transformer, we'll set that down here. The transformer, you can take a good look at a transformer here and pick up the numbers on it. Can you, you're gonna have to turn that.
No, I can see it.
Yeah?
Yeah, we're good.
So there again, that's the transformer. The brackets, I can show you the brackets here.
Might as well.
Here, here's a part number. This is that adjustable bracket I buy at the RC store. They're like $30 a piece, $35 a piece. It's a large, you gotta take extra large, not the large, extra large. All right, and the box, anybody who does electrical, is just a normal, no box. I drilled my own hole. I buy them blank with no holes in it. I can drill my own holes. I can set those two compartments inside the box and all my wire inside, right? That's what I use. So this is another $18, I guess.
Primarily, what are you using this for right now? Like, what are you just researching?
I'm just doing researching, electromagnetic field, radio transmission. And here, this is the pad I use for doing some tests. That's from an induction stove. For the stove, the top never gets hot. When you put the iron pan it, it actually heats up the iron. It's a radio frequency. It goes and resonates the iron molecule and heats up really, really fast. So it's literally a old style of the Tesla coil, right? But it's on multi-brand wire, and each little wire is insulated by yourself. So, you know, it's like I have like 100 little wires wrap around constantly there. So, and everybody are afraid, you know, the radiation. We have a tri-field meter, that's for electromagnetic field. And of course, we have a lot of that here. So that's the battery test. Now I'm gonna put it at 100 and I'm clicking right to the end. So my electromagnetic field is fairly, but it goes down as we're moving away very fast. Now you will have the same effect by putting that into your TV, a blender, anything. You will have that same effect when you go close, it goes right into the end of the red. So for therefore, it's no big deal. The biggest deal is active radiation. And active radiation, this is a Geiger used property of Texas Department of Health, right? So it's all been redone inside. It works perfectly. New battery, zero. The only thing is, those guys is they don't like the cold. They like constant temperature. Okay, we got zero. There we go. We have nothing. Nothing more than normal radiation from anybody, myself. And we're going to go right to the top. Now, radiation or magnetic field. Magnetic field is right to the max, but no radiation, no active radiation. And this thing will take all three types of radiation. Now, I also have another radiation detector, active radiation, which is digital. Well, digital detector, they're pretty much garbage unless you pay thousands of dollars and you have a shield in it. Because my other one, I come here and the Geiger, the digital Geiger goes so high, they say I'm supposed to be dead in 5 minutes. and it goes totally crazy because they're not shielded for electromagnetic field. I do have two more, we have two more units supposed to come, I think. Yeah. We're going to test two different ones. One is supposed to tell you the radiation, electromagnetic radiation, which I'm after, and to see how much I'm producing. And so that way I'll be able to see what effect you can do with the electromagnetic radiation, because this electromagnetic radiation is a cold radiation. And that's the reason why we can find, we can pick up different temperature, the temperature drop below zero, and a very, very, very deep sub-zero. And it's because the radiation, more radiation is, deeper the cold will be. And a lot of people, they thought I was crazy about it, but now I do have a lot of people, including physicists and scientists, who says, yeah, absolutely, cold radiation exists, it always existed, we just never talk about it. Well, again, the big mystery, we don't never talk about it. Well, you know, I like to know how deep this lake is before I jump off the dock. You know, this is enough water for me to dive, or I should just kind of crawl into it because it's rocks, you know, 2 feet from the surface. That's the world of science today. It's all a goddamn secrecy, just like the, you know, if you have a secret, I tell you what a secret is. It's because you're lying. That's the base of secret. If it's not a lie, what's the truth going to do to you? Right? And anybody who has secrets, you know, for concern, they're hiding stuff from people. If you're hiding something from people, you're a liar. Period. You know? So, I mean, that's what the government, you know, they have top secret people can't read, but they actually own those goddamn papers. So why the public cannot have the access to those papers? Matter of fact, I don't recall the government to own any country in the world, unless you're a king, and that's how it works over there. We don't have a king here. So who the hell sold Canada to the politician? As far as I'm concerned, I own the clothes they wore, they wear, the shoes they walk, the car they drive, and the gun they carry. Because they didn't pay for that. We paid for that. We own that. So people should get a little bit more sense of who owns what here. I mean, this, you're not going to believe that. This thing here, by the time, we're not counting my time, just counting my gas to run around and stuff like this and pick up other parts, right? Well, you're over $400. This is stupid. My first one cost me, well, because I had all the parts in the bag, cost me about $45 altogether. And it still run. But then I wanted to go a little bit fancy, so it's easier and quieter and stuff like this. And I went through a big headache with RC motor. Do not go with RC motor. With RC controller, do not work, because RC controller get affected by cold radiation and a high electromagnetic.
So Gerard, so what does this whole apparatus do for you and
I do tests with it. I do tests. I use them actually. I love the cold radiation, so I literally put that underneath the cushion in a chair and I sit on it, and I can 30 minutes, an hour, whatever, and it just charges you up. I mean, everybody said I was going to die of radiation and stuff like this, but I'm still not dying and I'm using it. Matter of fact, for a while I didn't use it. And I end up, you know, losing my vision. Something was happening. It was more likely stress because everybody wanted to put a deadline on stuff. And I tried to figure out a deadline on something you tried to figure out in the first place. And then I didn't have a machine. Everybody else around me had a machine. Because it's like, I'm like the shoemaker, right? You ever see a shoemaker's feet in his shoes compared to where the customer comes out and walks away with it? Well, I decided, no, I'm going to build myself one. I'm going to keep it here for doing tests. And other things. But it does recharge you in a large, large way. Everybody was sitting that thing for 30 minutes, and I make sure they don't lie to me, because I said, if I find out you lie to me, I'm going to beat the crap out of you because you're lying to me. I just want the honest, and they said, oh my God, I feel like, as soon as you sit for 5 minutes, they said, I can feel the energy right through you. I said, yeah, I can show you the energy go through you. I take a radiation, electromagnetic radiation detector, and I go around their head and above their head for about 2 feet, and the detector picks it up, no problem. So the all energy goes right through you and is a vortex. It spins slowly as it goes through you. But what I'm saying is it does stuff to your body. I can't tell you if it does stuff to your body to heal anything, whatever. Eat that stuff for me. I'm keeping that for myself. If you try it, it will do stuff for you. You will know exactly what I'm talking about.
Disclaimer, though.
I'm not telling people it does thing. You have to try it yourself. You know, you will feel the difference. I mean, like, if I put a glass of milk here, it changed the taste of the glass of milk. If I put vinegar here, you can drink the vinegar without choking yourself. It changed the taste of vinegar. You put water, it changed the taste of water. And we're talking about like 10 seconds when that thing run. Matter of fact, anything, you know, pot. I smoke pot. I don't really care. I smoke pot. You put pot on there and it's totally different. It changed the element. It realigned the element. And also, it fits right back into the information we're going to put on the end of the video about electromagnetic field and radiation. And it's a well-known thing. A radio wave, an electromagnetic field, does thing to people. Some does bad stuff to people and some does good stuff. But then again, I've been saying that from the beginning. You know, everything in a proper amount, it's always good. Look, your body, what it's got, the most poisonous thing, right? It's a metal. We have, if we don't have lead and mercury, or cadmium, barium, and gold, silver, if we don't have those minerals in a perfect amount in our body, we are sick. We have to have an amount of radiation in our body. When the radiation drops down, we are anemic. Like, we are a working genetic machine who need those material to function. But when the level goes up in one, we imbalance. We're sick. We have stuff going on. You know, I mean, like, it's like everything else. Like water. 3 glasses of water a day will keep you alive for the rest of your life. But shove your head under the water for more than 5 to 10 minutes. See how far you're going to go, right? But water save your life. But too much will kill you. This whole planet is on a system of balance. If you're not smart enough to be able to balance, then I can't help you. Then I would say you go into the classification as what they call that, natural selection, right? The natural selection, the stupid one dies, right? It's like the guy who go to the bar, and instead stopping at 3 drinks, you have to have 40. And then they kick him out of there and he rolled himself outside instead of walking and be able to go home. It's because he doesn't know when to stop. Because he doesn't know the difference between 1 and 20. Right? It's like the guy who eat 2 burgers and the guy who eat 50 burgers. Right? It's like, you know, people have no limits sometimes on some stuff. And that's because people have a problem. And it's not other people's problem. It's their own problem. They cannot deal and be able to control whatever their level is.
So if you change the light bulb, Gerard, mm-hmm. would that change the frequency?
No, the light bulb, when I started that, can you see the light going on very well? Okay, this is another thing. Everybody, they have their own theories. Like everybody, you know, a theory for me, you know, it's just like a, you know, it's like an asshole, everybody's got one. So my theory on that one is because we're spinning a magnet between an iron core and it's got a coil around, and I'm producing voltage, and I'm stepping up the voltage in the step-up transformer, but that voltage is radio volt, not AC volt. It's RF volt, through RF volt. And what I'm producing in this volt, right, it's pure electron, non-tarnished electron, the virgin. And that's the other the loose spark gap works.
To mess the screen up if I go too close.
Yeah. So here, those stream of electrons, right? Everybody think electron is a particle. I don't agree with that. For the first thing is, look at the boreal light. Now, the boreal light would be all over the place, but it's not. When you look in the boreal light, it's millions and millions and millions of tiny little stream going toward the earth. And the light stays in a certain altitude. That's because it's plasma. You have a very strong increase or release which way you're there, because it follows the fault of the earth, and then you have a release of electromagnetic field, which can excite the electron in a certain way. But the electrons are not a particle, because if it was a particle, how can you bend it? An electromagnetic field have a perfect line of electrons. Now, if you take tiny little bits and pieces and try to make this perfect line and bend the line, it's going to break. It's not solid. So for me, an electron, it's like a string. You can bend it, you can shape it, you can bottle it if you want into a capacitor, you can hold it, but it's a string. It's not a particle. And this, what you see in a tube there flowing, that tube could be 20 miles long. And you will see that same blue light going in. And what I think is electron and pure electron, because pure electron carry radiation, cold radiation, is when you turn this bulb on, it turns blue. And if you totally restrict it from lights, you can take the bulbs off, and the bulb will glow blue for 9 hours after you unscrew it in a dark room. This is called radiation decay on a very, very, very slow slope. I mean, it's fairly fast compared to the other radiation, but this is a non-active radiation. It's called radiation. So it takes about 8 to 9 hours to totally decay, because the radiation gets stuck in a high-pressure sodium glass. Now, when you say high-pressure sodium bulb, it's not the gas. It's the glass. That little tube inside is made at high-pressure sodium glass. That means heat resistant glass. And because it's made of that high pressure or sodium sulfate, I believe, something like this, it's a mineral. It'll imprint it. It's like a battery. It holds the charge of the radiation, and that's why it stays blue. But soon you put the light on it, it decays really fast. Without the light in the dark, it takes it takes 8 to 9 hours to decay. But it's still pretty fast for radiation. Since we have radiation, right, its half-life is 360 years. That's half-life. That means it drops down to half its power. So, it's pretty fast, 9 hours. And the nice thing about it, if you have radiation here and I turn the switch off, radiation is gone. It's like you turn the switch off of the radiation, because it's manufactured at the tank. Soon you stop manufacturing, it's gone. But it will bottle up. If I close all the door here and I run that, radiation will bottle up inside. You can actually fill up this whole room solid with radiation. And then you can pick up a little piece of wire, copper wire, and hang up in the air and put a voltmeter and put one lead to the floor and one into the wire, and you will have volt with it, because radiation converts itself to volt soon it hits a piece of copper. And that's how you pick up a little bit of voltage with copper outside. It's just common. Any physicist who knows his shit should knows about that. You know, so.
So you're gonna just continue to release videos when you have stuff to share, and you're gonna keep going with your research?
Absolutely. I'm just waiting for some parts right now. Of course, we're in the holidays, and even when everybody start working, this week is pretty much shot. The first week of January is pretty much shot. But I got parts for my generator, which I'm removing the iron out of it. I got some parts for also my controller, and soon I got that put together. Then I will be doing some tests, you know, to be able to crank up my voltage. The total voltage I'm trying to get is 16,000 volts, because I'm going to be feeding that into the transformer, the regular 14,004. But you always want to get more as a buffer. And those voltage, they cannot really burn you the transformer, because they're radio volts anyway. And they will be able to activate a full-size transformer. What I'm seeing right now, I should be able to activate with no problem a 25 kV transformer. So that means that's a 600 amp service. And it should be running by itself. That's not a problem, because we're going to be producing a shitload of power. And it's going to be very low power to produce it, because I'm removing the iron. Again, the iron is not your friend. The iron that was put there a long time ago, and it was left there because they didn't know about aluminum. because they didn't have access to a large amount of aluminum those days. It was the only aluminum they have. It was called pot casting aluminum, which it was a really heavy aluminum, and it was a slag from a material from a foundry. And that's what they were using for aluminum. They didn't have the fancy aluminum we have today. So now I'm doing that, and we'll do a test. We'll find out, because as I showed the video prior to you guys saw, I had lots of cogging on the motor. It was like turning a very high compression motor. By removing the aluminum, it removed the heat and it removing the resistance right off the back. So now you can spin with no resistance and create high voltage. So right there, out of the gate, I'm a winning horse, because I don't have the resistance to drag, and I don't have the cogging, and I'm not creating heat. So all the bad, that's all the enemy you have on a generator. Resistance, the cogging, and the brake system. And when you put a demand on it, you create a brake on it, because you get the iron, and the heat or the high demand create on the generator. So if you remove all the bad stuff out of it and keep the stuff that will actually create energy, you have no problem. You should be able to produce a shitload of electricity, which is radio volt. And that's another thing about the word electricity I don't really like. We did a little bit of research about the word electricity from Latin to Greek, and electricity says it means amber. And in Greek, it means attraction to the an amber who attract material, or attraction to the amber, and that's a far cry for what's coming out of the wall. So that's why I don't really believe in all the wording they're putting on their stuff, because literally it doesn't mean what it says, because you have to be able to pick a word who have the right definition for what the action is, for what the effect is. If you don't have the right words, we don't hear about radio volt or RF volt and all that stuff. We don't never hear about that unless you're in the field. The common people don't even know it's a different, it's dozens of different types of volts. And volts, far as I'm concerned, is a volume. It doesn't mean what it means. Volt, to me, it's a volume. When you're asking, what kind of equipment? What volt is running? 110 to 220. To me, that question I ask about a volume. I'm asking you if the volume is 120 or 240, right? So it's always a volume. So that's what I'm trying to try to figure out, the word that was actually fit for what we're doing, for what the experiment is and what the reaction is. And the word we have today don't fit what I'm doing. So that's why I'm changing some of the stuff, and I'm trying to explain the word we have doesn't really mean much on what they've been using for it.
Yeah, you're speaking essentially almost a new language, and it's pissing some people off, and it's exciting other people.
Well, you ever see the doctor, the way he write a prescription? Why he doesn't write a prescription in English? Right? Because they're all so afraid someone's going to pick up on it and be able to do their job, without going through the whole shebang they went. It's just, they covered their ass, literally, right? That's what this world is, cover my ass. Let's keep very quiet, because it's so simple, we have to keep quiet, because we'll be out of business in 4 days, right? So, anyway, that's about it, and hopefully this video will illuminate some of the people and probably piss off some other people.
Probably.
But I don't really care, so... you guys all have a good day, and have a good time watching the video. So, carry on. That's where I like to say a big thank you to literally everybody who helps me. And when I mean everybody who helps me, I include everybody. The people who support me money-wise, we know that one person is doing it, and I had a couple of people who did help me, in the beginning. I want to say a very big thank you. I won't mention any name, because they don't like their name mentioned, but they will recognize themselves. One person is in Australia, one person is in Toronto, and a few other little people around here, they kind of helped me out with stuff, and even sending me and giving me instrument tools, finding stuff for me in the internet and whatever. And also, the people who help me is the people who actually believe what I'm doing for what I'm doing it for. This is probably one of the biggest help I have, is having, you know, somebody behind me who actually believe it is a better way to make to produce energy and a cheaper way for people to actually around the world to be able to afford it. And if it's not for all those peoples and to support, you know, what I'm doing and to say yes, you know, and of course we have the odd one in the group, and you know, they think I should be pretty much put in an institution. I'm not, but you know, beside that, it doesn't slow me down when I hear those people, when I know I got so many people behind me who will help me out and believe in what I'm doing, and they can't wait to get this thing done and to be able to use it. So for everybody, a big thank you to the bottom of my heart, and hopefully I'll be able to finish this off, and I won't be stopping to do this till I'm totally finished, unless someone drive over me with a 5-ton truck. So at that point in time, you can rest assured I'm not giving up on anything. I'm very close. We're very, really close of breaking the whole thing up. Tesla is no longer a mystery to me. Actually, I can walk a step foot one by one and explain everything what Tesla was doing. So, and I can prove everything out. So at that point in time, people just have a little bit more patience. And again, thank you, and thank you very much for all the people who helped me and keeping my head above water so I can do this research. It's great. It's the best work I ever done in my life. Even when I'm working 24/7 now instead of working 4 or 5 days a week, but I love it. It's something. It's in my blood right now, and I'm curious to see more and more and more every day, and to learn more about everything. So thank you again. It's well appreciated in my heart.